Alright, welcome back from that break. The Nigerian Police Force did set up the Public Complaints Rapid Response Unit to deal with cases of misconduct filed in against the Nigerian police officers. And we've got in the studio the man who is in charge of that unit, Assistant Commissioner of Police, Abayomi Shogunle, is in the studio to look at how well the Nigerian Police Force has done. From January to March 2017, the quarterly report has come in showing that a total of 498 cases have been gotten across the country. Good morning, nice to have you join us.
Thank you very much. Good morning.
All right, looking at the recent report, 52.8% reduction in cases reported from 2016, where we had a total of 1,000 plus cases. For you, what do you think is the reason why we have this sharp drop?
At the PCRRU, we want to believe that different reasons are responsible for this decrease. For instance, the fact that police officers are conscious that their acts of unprofessional conduct can be reported by members of the public 24/7 and severe sanctions given in proven cases is part of it. And also the fact that the retraining programs regarding capacity building of our officers is also yielding the results it is supposed to. It's also part of it.
All right.
Okay. Now, looking at like what he mentioned earlier, we can't deny the fact that the issue of inapt behavior amongst, you know, security personnel, there have been countless cases all over Nigeria. And then looking at it now, if there are sanctions, you know, for inapt behaviors amongst security personnel, among the police officers, why do we still have, you know, we still have cases? Even some cases that cannot be reported amongst the Nigerians, some, they just, you know, probably because they don't want to follow it up, they just keep quiet, and then they are abused by these officers. And then we keep on having countless cases all over the country. I don't really have, you know, an accurate, you know, information, that data right now, but definitely we're on social media, we see cases of complaints every day. And it's like, my question is, if there are sanctions against this, why do we still have, you know, repeated number of cases?
You see, the simple truth is, either we like it or not, there will always be friction between the citizens and the law enforcement agents, either we like it or not. As long as people step out of their house on a daily basis to go about their duties, there would always be, and there are different reasons responsible for this. For instance, the way somebody who doesn't have a job would relate with a police patrol team on the road is different from somebody who is gainfully employed. Level of education of citizens, of individuals, determines the type of interaction they have with police officers. We've seen it all around the world. It's not only in Nigeria. And thank God, even the one we see here in Nigeria hardly result to loss of life. Unlike what we see in the United States of America. Almost.
I really agree with you on that. It hardly results to loss of life.
Here. Yes, yes, yes. There are very, very few cases where we've had where unfortunate incidents where citizens have lost their lives. You know, so I think the most important thing is also good for citizens to know their duties and responsibilities. Ignorance of the law is not a defense. And unfortunately, some of this misunderstanding between citizens and the police arise from police officers trying to enforce the law.
Well, in most cases, where citizens try to, you know, say, this is, I know my rights as a citizen, this is what it should be, Well, you find cases whereby because the officer has, you know, arms, he tries to, you know, impose, maybe when he sees that he's losing out, he tries to go the other way. There are cases whereby the citizens, yes, we want to say, I know my rights and I want to, this is what it is. But, you know, the officer in the other case, because he has arms, he wants to go violent. I mean, we've had cases, we keep on hearing cases like that every day. So I don't really agree when you say it's in a case whereby citizens don't know their rights, because even some citizens who know their rights and they try to talk about it, but they are hushed down because they have probably have arms with them and, you know, you're in a position. It's high time we, I don't know, do the security personnel, do they have to redefine their role in democracy? They're meant to protect lives and property, not, you know, harassing people.
You know, I don't know, probably if I've said citizens don't know their rights, that's not what I intended.
Okay.
I had wanted to say citizens don't know, most people don't know their duties. Duties expected of them.
Okay.
There are rights and responsibilities. It's one thing to know your right, is another thing to know the duty expected of you.
Okay.
Like, for instance, when a police officer stops you for routine stop and search, the police officer under the law has the power to stop you on the road without a warrant to search you.
Mm-hmm.
He can even ask you some questions which you think are unreasonable. For instance, what have you taken this morning? You are duty bound to answer, because you don't know the information the officer is working with.
Okay.
You don't know what information is trying to get. But, you know, unfortunately, we see some people sometimes they flare up unnecessarily, which leads to. And, you know, there is something in law that says a police officer has a power to do certain things upon reasonable ground, upon reasonable suspicion. Each time you try to move away from what answer he wants to get from you, you are probably making his suspicion to be stronger.
Okay.
You know? So these are little things that we should try and also understand. But the good thing is, irrespective of what happened, there is a unit set out by the Nigerian Police Force to receive such complaints and look into it and also to resolve it.
Okay.
All right, talking about that unit, recently, that was on Sunday, 14th May, we had this video that went viral of a police van in Edo State, I think that's Esige Division, where they handcuffed a suspect, so to say, to a van. Though it was said the van dragged him along the road, but from the report we got, your report now, first quarter, it did make mention of the fact that the video at no time did show the suspect being dragged.
Yeah.
So does that, what's the implication of that stand of the Nigerian police? Does it make illegal the actions of the Nigerian police? Let's assume that he was not actually dragged on the road.
You see, investigations are still ongoing by the Office of the Assistant Inspector General of Police in charge of Zone 5, Benin City. So I will try as much as possible not to preempt
the outcome
of the investigation.
Okay.
I will only concentrate on what we already have in the public domain.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, you know, we've seen a lot of over exaggeration of events. We received the video, I think, on Tuesday morning at the PCRRU last week, Tuesday, about 1:34, where it was tagged that police van was dragging a suspect on the road. It is there is no excuse or justification for police vehicle to drag anybody, irrespective of the crime. But you know what? That never happened. The police vehicle never dragged the young man. Even throughout the video, the police vehicle never dragged the young man. And except somebody whose skin is as thick as elephant. That's the only person that will be dragged on the floor, and the person will not have a single scratch.
Okay.
We're now going into forensic investigation.
The
young man that was alleged to have dragged has no single scar on his body. His coat, his clothes
wasn't
torn. So is it possible for somebody to have been dragged on the road without having a single scare? Immediately, PCRRU went into it. We got details from the police officers involved of what happened. And according to the police officers, they said they went to verify an information regarding cult activities. There is report from the neighborhood of incessant disturbance by suspected cult members, which has led to injury of some innocent people. The police have a legitimate duty to perform regarding that, and they went. And as they got there, according to the police officers, they said immediately the police vehicle was coming, the cult members boarded the vehicle, they gave the police the description, and they fled. And the police patrol team caught up with the vehicle, made some arrests. Some fled. It is the normal procedure when you are arresting a suspect. The first thing, you search the person because of the safety of the officer making the arrests, the safety of the person being arrested, and the safety of other people around, and also to enable recovery of exhibits, which might be related to the case or some other case. And weed suspected to be Indian hemp were discovered. As we speak today, Indian hemp is not yet legalized in Nigeria. So it is an offense for you to have Indian hemp or to smoke Indian hemp. We have some countries where it has been legalized, but as we speak, it is not yet legalized in Nigeria, so it remains an offense. And powder suspected to be cocaine were also recovered. And based on that, the police loaded the suspects into the vehicle. Go around the world, even in US.
Because even in the report, it was said the suspect tried to jump.
I will get to that.
My question is it possible someone who is handcuffed to jump from a vehicle? That makes the story a little bit.
You see, this is the job we do. Certain things you think are not possible, we have seen it. It happens. Then also considering
when he's handcuffed to an iron, is it like he was going
What happened before the suspects tried to jump, according to the police, that some of the people in the area, they prevented the police vehicle from moving. Of course, once a group of people stopped the police vehicle from moving, anything can continue to happen from that sense, you know. So just as I've said, investigations are ongoing. The AIG in Zone 5 turned in an interim report to the Office of the Inspector General of Police on Friday. And from the interim report, which I think I have a copy here, there's nothing to show that the suspect was actually dragged. There is nothing to suggest that
even if he was dragged,
no, it's wrong.
You would not expect the Nigerian police, the officers specifically, would not come out.
They really admit.
Of course, well, if they are not bold enough,
because you urged people to come, people who had footage of the event in your report that we have. If there's anyone who has footage of what happened, to come forward. But one other question is the fact that we also had stories that some persons were allegedly arrested when they wanted to pick up their phone, or those that were trying to video the event.
That's what I'm saying. Based on the interim reports, there is nothing to suggest that happened. Meanwhile, the officers involved, they are undergoing trial in Audley Room. For some offenses stated under the police regulations. So let's wait for the outcome of the Audley Room before we can now push additional story.
When are
to
we
members.
Likely to get feedback of that particular?
Of course, Audley Room procedures don't take a lengthy period of time.
Okay.
Probably before the end of this week or next week, we'll get additional information from the AIGs on 5 and
sorry, just a final question before we wrap up. Looking at the list of cases, Lagos seem to have the highest case, followed by the FCT. How does that make you feel in terms of the cases you've gotten for the first quarter? And what is that a reflection of probably how good these officers are in the different states, Lagos having 59?
Honestly, I'm not on ground in Lagos,
okay.
so I can't speak
for
the
Lagos
State Police
okay.
Command. But the data we've turned out are real. These are information and report as received from members of the public. But you know, one good thing, again, one positive thing, which I believe we can see from this report is when we go through to page 6, we're going to discover that in the first quarter of last year, we had 239 cases from Lagos, which has dropped to 90 cases. You know, and in FCT Abuja, we had 190 cases in the first quarter of 2016, and first quarter of 2017, we're having 69. In the total nationally, we had 1,054 cases in the first quarter of last year, compared to 489 cases, which is a significant drop, about 52.8%. Drop in number of cases, and to me, I think it's a positive direction.
Okay.
Just as I've said, we always have
cases.
Some cases are genuine, some are false, some are legitimate.
Is there a penalty for false information?
There is under the law, but we don't want to start using that now because we don't want to discourage
people
from. Making reports. I think I was reading in the news over the week, one of the agencies,
EFCC,
one of the agencies charged some people to court
for false information.
It's a criminal offense, but you know, we don't want to use that for now because we don't want to discourage people from making reports.
Were you sad when you saw one case in Kebbi State? Kebbi never had any case, but recently they had one case.
Well,
what does that tell us?
Probably, you know, there is this saying, some people believed that probably people in Kebbi State are not aware of the existence of the unit. But I think to me, it's a positive step, and I think it's a positive step.
Your last question.
If I let you go, just on behalf of citizens of Nigeria, I want to ask you, it's a yes or no question, actually. Is it right for officers to board vehicles, commercial vehicles, without making payments?
It's wrong.
Okay.
But cases are determined based on existing circumstances.
Okay.
I think it's good we go further to look at why is that happening. Is it something the commercial buses drivers are happy with, or are they the ones that are allowing it, and for what reason? But generally, it is wrong.
All right. Thank you very much.
All
thank
right.
You
I want to say
me.
A big thank you to the Assistant Commissioner of Police, Abayomi Shogunle, for doing justice. As regards all the cases they've gotten for the first quarter of 2017, as regards the misconduct of the Nigerian police force officers. About so far, from the report we've gotten for the first quarter, it says it's good ratings for the Nigerian police, shows that the officers are doing the job, and the Nigerian police is turning out to become a better force for every one of us. I want to say thank you for the good work you're doing, and I hope that you continue.
Thank you very much for having me.
All right, after this break, we shall be having our second guest to talk on viral hepatitis scourge in Nigeria. Just stay with us.
My name is Ibrahim Sulemalgui.
My name is Dr. Matthew Ashikeni. I am Dr. Muhammad Adamu Askira.
My name is Comrade Tosin Adeyanju. Keep watching.
Keep on watching.
Keep watching.
The program New Day.
New Day. New Day on People's Television.
People's TV. People's TV.
My name is Ibrahim Sulemalgui.
My name is Dr. Matthew Ashikeni. I am Dr. Muhammad Adamu Askira.
My name is Comrade Tosin Adeyanju. Keep watching.
Keep on watching.
Keep watching.
The program New Day.
New Day. New Day on People's Television.
People's TV. People's TV.
My name is Ibrahim Sulemalgui.
My name is Dr.